was he was sitting in the masjid with Yahya ibn Ma'in, a great scholar in the field of al-jarh wa al-ta'dil, the one that studies the authenticity or the credibility of the narrators. That they were both sitting in the masjid, and here stands up, somebody stands up and he says, I was told by Ahmad ibn Hanbal and Yahya ibn Ma'in. And he mentioned a fabricated hadith. Ahmad ibn Hanbal looked as Yahya ibn Ma'in, he told him, did you tell him that? And he said, I didn't. Did you not? No, I did not. So Ahmad ibn Hanbal told him, hey, wait a minute. I am Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and here is Yahya ibn Ma'in, and neither of us told you that. And the man says, wallahi, you know, some people don't back off. They go even further. And the man says, wallahi, you're so ignorant. You think you're the only Ahmad ibn Hanbal and Yahya ibn Ma'in. And he says, I narrated from 10 Ahmad ibn Hanbal and 10 Yahya ibn Ma'in. Yani, subhanAllah, some people are like that. You know, and there are certain, by the way, class of ahadith that are called mutawatir. What is mutawatir? Hadith mutawatir. Anybody knows what is mutawatir?
Different sources.
Different chains, you know. When you're talking about a hadith, it comes from, let's say, person A, B, C, and D to the Prophet. There are certain hadith that came through so many different sources, you know, independently of one another. And these, the scholar says, anyone that rejects any of these hadith, that's an act of kufr. Because they reach the level of authenticity of the Quran in a way. You know, one of those hadith, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام saying, من كذب علي كذب علي متعمدا فليتبوأ مقعده من النار. Anyone that fabricates a lie on me, then in a way he reserved his place in hellfire. This hadith, some of the scholars they say that came through 200 actually Sahabi narrated this hadith independently of one another. And the Jawzi mentioned 80 of them. That's why there are certain hadith that reach that level of conclusiveness. So after, at the end of the day, after we have this product, which is the authentic guidance of the Prophet ﷺ, and we establish that the Prophet ﷺ actually said that, then it becomes a fard for us to take this guidance. Like I said, sometimes we may not follow it because a person may be weak, a person may forget or whatnot. This is not what I'm talking about. But the Quran itself tells us that we have to take the guidance of the Prophet ﷺ. And when Allah commands us to take the guidance of the Prophet, Allah knows that there will be the vehicle to achieve that. Allah will not command the irrelevant. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that the guidance of the Prophet ﷺ will be preserved just as the Quran was preserved. You know, the same mouth gave us both. The same mouth gave us the Quran and also gave us the Sunnah, his own guidance. So if you establish that they're both said by him, why would you accept one and reject the other? When actually one tells you to follow the other. That's why following the guidance of the Prophet becomes a must. Or taking his guidance is the fulfillment of testifying to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that Prophet Muhammad is his Prophet and Messenger. I will stop here at least for now unless somebody doesn't know. If you have any question or comment, inshallah, we can go on. Yes?
How many Mutawatir
are there? I don't know. As a, I don't have any Mutawatir. But there are fewer, of course. Far fewer than the others. But it doesn't mean if it's not Mutawatir, it's never authentic, by the way. Like I said, you know. Yeah, the scholars have looked at the ahadith of Bukhari, you know, and at the end, all of them established or gave them their approval steps, so to speak. That's why Muhammad ibn Taymiyyah says if anybody disagrees with Bukhari, then all the time Bukhari is the one who's right. It has been proven. It's not just because it's Bukhari, but it has been verified actually. SubhanAllah, he had such a strict, you know, requirements. One of the things that he was required, you know, let's say for example you have a chain of narrators. And in the chain, let's say for example, we have Rahmatullah and we have Rahman. But studying the biography of each one of them, we find out that Rahmatullah lived all of his life in California. Rahman lived all of his life in France. Well, how could he narrate from him? Or that, for example, that one of them died before the other one was born. Then how could he narrate from him? That's why the science of studying of this, of you know, establishing the authenticity of the ahadith is the most difficult thing. It's something the effort cannot be duplicated. Cannot be duplicated as it was afterward. Now some of the scholars came and they studied certain hadith further, but to start from scratch like they did, that effort cannot be repeated. Yes?
I think there's some controversy coming from, I don't know, who is bringing the controversy, but some people are saying that it's not in Quran, so why should we obey this?
Take the Sunnah?
No, yeah. Say, for example, few things that people have are controversial to maybe interest, maybe the hijab or one more thing. So, you know, basically they are saying that the Quran is not saying that. Why should we? So basically, we are rejecting Ahadith.
I mean, that's my whole lecture actually is to answer that. Okay, it's the same
question.
What? Well, the question is that there are some people that raise certain issues, is that there are certain things that we don't have to take them there in the Hadith, you know, they're not from the Quran. That's why I would say, well, if you want to take the Quran says you have to take it. And there are certain things that are fard. That are fard that came from the Sunnah of the Prophet and not from the Quran. Like I said, the five daily prayers. You know, that's a fard. We do it as a fard. It's not in the Quran. Allah says, establish the salat. And there's some hint about some time in the beginning. أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ طَرَفَيْهِ النَّهَارِ وَزُلَفَ مِنَ اللَّيْلِ. But when and how often, that's not from the Quran. Though it's a fard. That's why the fard does not only come from the Quran, by the way. There are certain fard that comes from the Sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And there are certain things that are Sunnah that are anyway optional. You know, mustahab, that come from the Quran. Qiyam al-layl, Allah mentioned, for example, in Surah Al-Muzzammil. You know, at the end of the Surah, Allah mentioned that it's in a way optional. Now, by the way, but some of the things that you mentioned are in the Quran. Like the hijab is in the Quran. The hijab is not only, of course, the Prophet also mentioned it, but Allah mentioned it in the Quran as well. So that's why there are certain things, but subhanAllah, sometimes people may not be aware of that. That's why somebody asked, you know, has there been a difference in opinion actually about whether hijab is required or not? I told them, among the scholars, there's no difference in opinion. Among the people that do not have the knowledge, yes, there is a difference in opinion. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that in the Quran clearly. You know, when Allah said, وَلَدْرُبْنَا بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ وَلْيُدِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ. What does that word mean? What is that word? I mean, I cannot invent words. I cannot invent meanings or give the words new meanings. When Allah says khimar, so people say, well, khimar actually is a cover. It is not a head cover. Well, let's look at the word for a second. You know, whenever you want to explain a word from the Quran, you have to look, of course, at the classical Arabic language at the time of the Prophet. You have to look at the meaning of the word, the way it was used at the time of the Prophet, not wallahi, because words acquire new meanings with time. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, for example, As-sa'ihuna was-sa'ihat. What's sa'ih today in today's Arabic language?
Tourists.
So Allah is encouraging tourism? Is that what it's saying? The word means something different. The way it is mentioned. The new meaning that we use now for sa'ih or sa'ih is tourism. That's why you have to look at the way it was used at the time of it. If you look linguistically, khimar means covering the head. Look at, you know, the ultimate source or reference in the Arabic language is what's called the Sam al-Arab al-Muhit. This is a dictionary, about 15 volumes. If you look in there, it says that khimar means head cover. That's why, by the way, what's alcohol in Arabic? Khamr. Why is it called khamr? Because it clouds the mind, the head. It doesn't cloud the feet. That's why it clouds it, so it covers in a way the mind, the top of the head. That's why it's called khamr. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says khimar, which the plural is khumr or khimir or a few other actually expressions. That there's a hadith by the Prophet ﷺ that says that man can wipe over his turban and the woman can wipe over her khimar. What did he mean by that? That man can wipe over his head and the man can wipe over her socks. It means that the khimar to the woman is like the turban to the man. That's what it means, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. That's when you look at the language. You look at the meaning of the language at the time of the revelation. So the hijab is in the Quran. The hijab is in the Quran. Of course, the Sunnah of the Prophet explains it further. But the hijab is mentioned in the Quran and a few other things as well. The same thing with the interest that is mentioned in the Quran. You know, but sometimes... I'll take your question. Allah, subhanAllah, sometimes we try... you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the beginning of Ali Imran, هُوَ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ مِنْهُ آيَاتٌ مُحْكَمَاتٌ هن أم الكتاب وأخر متشابهات فأما الذين في قلوبهم زيغ فيتبعون ما تشابه منه ابتغاء الفتنة وابتغاء تأويله. That to the end of the verse. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the Quran is made of two kind of verses. There's the conclusive verse آيات المحكمات with very clear meaning. Allah says, هن أم الكتاب. These are the foundation of the book. And there's another book of verse called the المتشابهات that have a double meaning, or the meaning is not clear. Now, how do you explain this المتشابهات, the allegorical, in light of the محكمات, of the conclusive? So you do not take something that has more than one meaning. Now, some of the scholars says this is referring to the aqidah, but it can be used with other things as well. Yet one, a person told me that once, by the way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, and also Ali Imran, that يَعْلِمَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَأْكُلْ رِبَا أَضْعَافًا مُضَاعَفًا وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. That all you who believe do not eat a riba interest in fools. يعني I give you something, give it to me two times, three times and all of that. So he says, well, Allah says, do not eat it in full, I'm eating it in percentage. So that means it's permissible. Yeah, because subhanAllah, see how people play games sometimes. How about the other verse? Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعُ وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَى. Allah made selling and buying halal, you know, and made the riba haram, that's it. Why do you take one verse and explain it however you want, disregarding the other verse? But that's why the text has to be taken in its totality. And the same thing when the people say, well, like, I will follow the Quran. Yeah, the Quran says you follow the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Yes?
One question. I correct me if I'm wrong. After a man from Central Asia emerged to write Sahih Bukhari from Bukhara, I think it was 257 years after the death of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So all the Sahabis and all those things must have been died for sure, because it was 257 years. And so what kind of tool they used to use to gather all the information, and how they used to testify those things? It must be a very difficult task. Yes.
Well, see, that's why what they do, yeah, it is easy for anyone to say, well, I fabricate certain hadith. You know, I was told by Abdullah, by Ibrahim, by so, by... I mentioned one of the Sahabi, Abdullah ibn Umar, here the Prophet saying that. You know, that's easy to say. That's why the task is very difficult in order to verify whether it's correct or not. First of all, that they said that the person, or the people that are named in that chain, have to be known. They have to be known. That's why I cannot invent. Yeah, let's say, for example, you say that there's a person, his name is Abdullah. Well, which Abdullah? There are so many Abdullahs. You know, all of us are Ibadullah, you know. They said, or for example, that says, well, you give a name, Abdullah ibn so-and-so. But that person is not known to anybody. Let's cross it out. That's why when you say that that Ahmad Muhammad out of 750,000, he brought it down to about 30,000. That's a lot. He's screaming a lot. So first of all, the person has to be known. Okay? That's one thing. The second thing is that the people that are named, they study each person by himself. That the credibility he has to know, to be known, to be a trustworthy person. If he made a lie, you cross him out. That's it. Even if he repented, some of them will cross it out. That's the second thing. And this is not the easy thing. The third one, or the following one, is that the person has to be able to recall the information. Why? Because the person may be trustworthy, but he may have memory faults. Or that the person may be good when he was young, but as he was getting older, his ability to recall, you know, gets compromised. So they would mention that this was, you know, was mentioned toward the end of his life. So they would, that's the other thing. The other thing is that they would study, you know, the continuity. So let's say, for example, these names that I mentioned, it should have been documented that these people met each other. So they would start with the last person. Let's say, for example, I was told by A, B, C to the Prophet. Okay, let's say A, person A. Who told me that? Well, I studied, if I can trust that person, if I can trust that this, let's give some names. Let's say, for example, again, Radwan Abdur and Rahmatullah. Rahmatullah told me that he heard from Radwan, that he heard from somebody else. Okay? Now, once I study the biography of Rahmatullah, and I established that he's a trustworthy person, so if he told me that he heard it from Radwan, that means he did hear it from Radwan. Now, my second step is to go to Radwan's, study the biography of Radwan. And if Radwan says that he heard it from somebody else, I move to the following step, which is a very difficult task. So they studied the biography in details, you know, until at the end, they ended up with the final product, you know. And of course, the more people you have in the chain, in a way, the less, or the more likelihood of an error there will be. That's why the chain that I mentioned is called the golden chain. And Uqba and Nafi' and Ibn Umar alayhi wa sallam. That's it. From Imam Malik ibn Anas to the three people that are known. So it's a very difficult job. It's a very difficult job, but at the end, you can establish that. You can establish that. That's why I said the history of Islam has no parallel in any